All right. Yesterday, actually, we took a look at several forms of cash flows. So, at a glimpse, we just took a look at We just took a look at several forms of cash flows. We said that there is lump sum, and we did work examples on this. We said there is multiple cash flows, as well as annuity and perpetuity, which can be growing annuity or growing perpetuity. And to look at the worked example. Now, before going further to multiple cash flows here, annuity and perpetuity, I would like to introduce one more important thing, because actually it's like we did it, but in an indirect way. When say you have invested and the interest is being compounded several times in a year, more than once. So it's better that we take a look at this. If you remember yesterday, we said that the more the compounding, the more the value. If you compound more, the value increases. That goes to show that if you are told that the interest rate per annum is 10%, but it is compounded quarterly, say, that goes to show that the actual cost payable is more than 10%, because interest is compounded more than once in a year. And so there is something called effective annual rate. So we'll look at this term here shortly. Effective annual rate. What is effective annual rate? That goes to show that if a bank tells you that you pay us an interest rate of 10%, but they insert a covenant that the interest will be compounded monthly, that shows that the interest actually payable in a year will be more than 10%. And they would wish to know that actual interest rate. And that's why you call it effective. That means the interest actually implied in the terms. So welcome, Sanjay. So just before going to the effective annual rate, let's take a look at these two terms. Quoted and effective interest rates. What are the quoted and effective rates? What are these rates? If you are told quoted or stated or normal interest rate, actually this is the same thing, quoted, stated or nominal interest rate. This is just the rate that is specified. If you are told that the interest rate per annum is 10%, that the quoted, stated or nominal interest rate, it's not an effective interest rate. You may be told that the interest rate is 14% per year, but also it is compounded maybe four times in a year, maybe quarterly, it is compounded quarterly. If you are told that it is compounded quarterly, that goes to show you that you have to compute the effective annual rate so as to know the true cost of, say, the loan that you have been provided with. So that's why here we are saying that the sorry, I think there was some intervention here. I don't know why. Yeah, I think we are back now. So actually, the quoted rate can also be known as the nominal APR. APR means annual percentage rate, which lenders such as banks and credit companies are required to disclose. So let's say it's a bank. A bank is just required to disclose the nominal rate, but actually they may specify in the terms that this rate will be compounded maybe annually, semi-annually, quarterly, things like that. So now let's go to our main topic, effective annual rate. So by effective annual rate, we seek to know the actual interest rate implied in the terms. Someone has told me that the quoted rate is 10% per year, but it is compounded monthly. That means if it's compounded monthly, the actual rate implied is more than 10%, because the more the compounding, the more the value. So here we just seek to compute the effective annual rate. So that's why you are told that it is a corresponding annual rate when interest is compounded at intervals shorter than a year. So this is just the definition, but this has got more point. It is the rate actually implied. The rate actually implied in the term. You combine the quoted rate, you combine also the number of compounding in a year to arrive at the effective annual rate. So interest may be compounded daily. That means if you compound interest daily, then in a year, the year has 365 days. So the number of compoundings will be 365. If you compound it each weekly, there are 52 weeks in a year. So the number of compoundings in a year will be 52. Compound it monthly, and there are 12 months in a year. So it will be 12. And compound it quarterly, there are 4 quarters in the whole thing. So M would be equal to 4. That number of compounding that we usually call M. I think we looked at it yesterday. M, this is M here. So you could do something like this. This is M. All right, so how do you obtain the effective annual rate? Obtaining the effective annual rate is something very simple. You just take 1 plus, you take your quoted rate, divide by M, and then this M divide just the quoted rate, not 1. 1 is just alone. Then you close your brackets and you raise it to the power of M. And the resulting answer, you subtract 1 from the resulting answer. And you have your effective annual rate. If you try to remember, you could find something like this. Let me show you something here. Let me show you something. If you remember yesterday, we said that future value equals to present value times 1 plus R raised to the power of N. It was like this. We said raised to the power of N. So after raising it to the power of N, we said that in case you have been given something that interest is compounded more than once, we just said that you come to R here, you divide by M, and then we come to this N here, you multiply it by M, just like this. So if you look, you'll just find some similarities, a bit of similarities. Here we are just seeking the effective annual rate. So we got no concern about the present values. We just need the interest. And so we also have no concern to this N. So you arrive at this. So this one that we looked yesterday is actually what I just tried to show you here. So actually, that's the formula for effective annual rate. You need the effective annual rate, and you just have to use that formula. Now I want us to go to an example and try to demonstrate what we have just studied. So as we said yesterday, M is the number of time periods in a year. That means the number of compounding in a year. And we are given here that, for example, for annual compounding, if you compound annually, that means after 1 year, you have just compounded once. So M would be equal to 1. Semi-annual compounding semi-annually, that means there are two halves in a year, M equals to 2. Quarterly, M would be equal to 4. If you compound monthly, M would be equal to 12, and so on and so on. So let's just go directly to a worked example to see what you have to do. We are just going now. Let's find an example. So this one is for multiple cash flows. Yeah. Question number 5. Let's look at this. Take a look at this question. We are told that JJ needs a certain amount of money and he has chosen to borrow from a bank. And the following are available offers. So we have the following offers available in the banks. Suppose it were you need to borrow something, you have gone to the banks who are lenders, and they offer several terms. Bank AA lends at 9.8% compounded semi-annually. This is the first bank. Then you could say, 9.8% maybe is too huge. Let me go to another bank. You go to bank PB and you find 9.7. You think that this could be much less costlier. But going further, you find that it is compounded weekly, while this one was compounded semi-annually. A week, there are 52 weeks in a year, so compounding it weekly actually would increase the cost. So to really know which cost is higher, you would have to compute the effective annual rate. And bank C lends at 10% compounded annually. So at a glance, if you didn't use the effective annual rate concept, you would directly go to bank B, because this rate seems much lower, but actually you have to compute so as to be sure of the bank to choose. Because the rate at a glance, at face value, seems lower, but it is compounded weekly and there are 52 weeks in a year. So M equals to 52 compared to semi-annually where M equals to 2 and annually where M equals to 1. Now we go to the question. We are told, from which bank should JJ borrow in order to minimize interest cost? Actually, the question doesn't have to specify in order to minimize interest cost. If you are borrowing and you have several sources to choose, it's obvious that you would go for the source offering the services at a cheaper cost, at the cheapest cost. So, and the question proceeds here. Yeah? In case the term above were for investors, if they are for investors and JJ instead wish to invest, what choice would he have made? Now, if you invest, that means that you get the money. So you would go for the higher, for the highest interest. If you borrow, that means you pay, you incur the cost. So you would go for the lowest cost. Now let's start to see how you have to deal with this question. If you find a question of this nature, you have to compute the effective annual rate for each bank. We have three banks there, Bank A, Bank B, as well as Bank C. So we compute the effective annual rate to determine the interest rate actually implied over the year, just like that. So we have it here, effective annual rate equals to 1 plus R over M power M minus 1, just like that. And we go here we have, let's start with Bank AA. We are told that the rate is 9.8% compounded semi-annually. So the rate here, 9.8%, or 0.098 compounded semi-annual. So M equals to 2 in a year. So if you have M equals to 2, you would come to compute the effective annual rate. So effective annual rate here equals to 1 plus, you have R 0.098 over M, which is 2, power 2. Then the resulting answer is subtract 1, and you end up with 10.04%. So this is the rate actually implied. So as you see here, by looking here, it was 9.8%, but right now it's 10.04%. You find that the rate has actually increased. So let's go to Bank BB. Bank BB, we are given the terms here that the rate is 9.7% compounded weekly and there are 52 weeks in a year. So this is the rate. 0.097 and M equals to 52. Then we have the effective annual rate here. This is 1 plus 0.097, which is the rate over 52, then power 52, and you minus 1. You end up with 10.18%. I think you can see what has happened, just happened here. So the 9.7, which initially at face value seemed to be lower, has actually resulted in an interest rate 10.18 that is higher than this one, 10.04. And then we go to Bank CC. Bank CC, we have been told that Bank C lends at 10% compounded annually. I think you don't have to do anything here because we are looking for the effective annual rate and the compounding itself is done annually. So there is no need to do anything. That actually is already the effective annual rate. Even if you attempt to do, there'll be nothing new because we will take 1 plus R, which is 0.1, 10% over M, which is 1 power 1, which changes nothing. Then if you subtract 1, you remain with 10%. Nothing has changed here. So just compare here. I have Bank A, 10.04, Bank B, 10.18, as well as Bank C, 10%. So if you need to borrow, you actually need to minimize cost. So to minimize the cost, from which bank would you choose? Bank A is 10.04, Bank B 10.18, and Bank C is 10%. You find that the bank which initially seemed to offer services at the highest cost is actually the cheapest one. So you would go for Bank C as the cost actually implied is low, is the lowest. That's why we say, by borrowing, JJ would wish to minimize interest cost, and so should borrow from the bank offering the least effective annual rate, and this would be Bank CC. Now is the question asked again here, this one, that in case the terms above were for investors, if JJ instead wished to invest, he would wish for the highest return. So to obtain the highest return, he would go to the bank offering the highest rate, and the highest rate here is 10.18, and this is come from Bank B. So that's why we say, by investing, JJ would wish to minimize interest income, to maximize interest income, sorry, and so he should invest into the bank offering the highest effective annual rate, and this would be Bank BB, just like that. So just like that, I think we are done with the effective annual rate. We could just proceed through with other forms of cash flows now. Let's just take a look at other forms of cash flows. Other forms of cash flows. Let's go to multiple cash flows. Then after multiple cash flows, there is annuity. We have ordinary annuity due. Actually, we'll see them. So we can just proceed here. Multiple cash flows. Actually, this one is also just something it's just very direct. We just go with the same approach. We use exactly the same approach. So we are told here that multiple cash flows. Let's say you are told that you receive $100,000 at the end of year one, maybe $50,000 at the end of year two, $40,000 at the end of year three, something like that. You receive cash flows not once. Initially, we just dealt with cash flows that we are receiving only once. But right now, it's not just once. We receive cash flows multiple times. So there'll be something much easier to deal with here. All right. So we are saying that there can be different cash flow amounts at different times, and individual cash flows are discounted or compounded and then aggregated to form a single value. Say you receive $100,000 at the end of year one, $50,000 at the end of year two, $40,000 at the end of year three. You need to compute the present value. You just discount each cash flow separately and you add them together. That's why we say you aggregate them. With this formula here, present value equals to, you take your cash flow, just take your cash flow, discount it to the present value, and then add them together. Just like that, and you are done. So let's just go directly to an example. This one, number four. So let's go to example four. We are told that a firm expects to receive 20 million at the end of year one, 25 million at the end of year two, and 15 million at the end of year three. So you expect to receive these amounts at the end of years one, two, and three. Then what are we required to do? Required here, compute the current worth of the future cash flows. This is the first question. Current worth of the future cash flows. Current worth means the present value. So you expect to receive this much amounts in the future, and you need to know their worth now. That's why we say the current worth of the future cash flows. But also the question proceeds, we are told that in the future value at the end of year three, if the relevant discount rate is 10%. So we are told to compute the present value as well as the future value and at the end of year three. So how do we go about this? If you just collect your data, we are told that 20 million is at the end of year one. So cash flow one is 20 million, cash flow two at the end of year two, 25 million, and at the end of year three, 15 million. So, and this is the rate, interest rate, which is 0.1. Just like that. So you can now go further and compute the present value. So let's go to the present value, compute it. So if you need the present value, just take a look. 20 million was received at the end of year one. So if it was at the end of year one, as you see here, you discount it one time. Cash flow two at the end of year two, you discount it two times here. And the cash flow three at the end of year three, you discount it three times, just like this. So you obtain your present value here,